and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, it's in His name that we welcome you to worship this morning at First Presbyterian Church. We are thrilled that you are here with us on this holiday weekend to worship our Lord together. Tomorrow might be Labor Day, but today is the Lord's Day, and we come into His house to worship His name in spirit and in truth, knowing that the Lord has promised to give success to His people as they gather together. He has promised in His Word to bear much fruit from this time into eternity as we gather in His name and His house on His day. And so as we worship our God in a way that is regulated by His Word, we know that the climax, the pinnacle of our worship service is indeed the reading and preaching of His Word. That is how our God, our Father in heaven, speaks to us, and He tells us in John chapter 17 that He will sanctify us by it. And so as we come, I hope you've come with much anticipation, for our Lord will speak to us and He'll also sanctify us this very morning. He'll conform us more into the image of His Son. That is a guaranteed good work that He will do as we listen diligently to Him. There are a few announcements that I want to highlight here before we enter into worship. On the back of your bulletin, page 8, you'll see that there are a number of announcements there for your information. The first one I want to highlight is that the church office will be closed tomorrow in observance for Labor Day. If you need any assistance, please reach out to the pastors or your care group leaders, but the office will be closed tomorrow. Maggie and Robert will begin leading discipleship groups on Sunday evenings for our youth. And so you'll see that there's times available there. So next Sunday evening will be September the 11th. The 6th through 9th grade will meet from 5 to 6. Then they'll break for evening worship. And then 10th through 12th grade will meet from 7:15 to 8:15 p.m. We also kicked off our Wednesday night programs this past Wednesday night. We had a great meal together, many children and youth participating in our programs. And of course, we had a great time of prayer and kicking off a new series on the Ten Commandments during our adult prayer meeting. And so if you weren't with us last Wednesday and you are interested in being a part of our midweek services, we would ask that you would be present with us. It is a great time of fellowship, of discipleship, and our Lord has definitely blessed those times of prayer and the means of grace there during the midweek. And so we hope that you would be a part of our time. Let me remind you of those ritual of friendships found on the back of every pew next to your hymnals. If you'll grab those, pass them on down your aisles. We'd love to have any updated contact information you might have. We would love to know if you're visiting with us so that we can reach out to you and let you know how great it was to have you in the house of the Lord. But for now, let us prepare our hearts for worship.
To praise.
As we enter into the courts of heaven in praise and in worship, we turn our eyes upon Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. As His Word calls us to worship, you'll see our responsive call to worship there on page 2. Like each and every week, I'll read the regular print and we'll read together the bold. If you'll please stand as we are called to worship by our God. Coming from Psalm 28, verses 6 through 9. Blessed be the Lord, for He has heard my voice. The Lord is my strength and my shield. In Him my heart trusts. My heart exults. And with my song I will give thanks. As we give thanks to the Lord for His marvelous blessings, let us turn now to hymn number 101. Come Thou Almighty King. Hymn number 101. Let's sing together.
Thank you. Lord, we pray you would continue to cause us to have giving hearts, Lord, that we'd be quick to share with those who have need. And we do pray that these gifts would be used for the advancement of your kingdom, Lord, that we'd be wise stewards of the gifts that you give us. We thank you and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, if you all would take your hymn books again and turn to hymn number 629, please remain standing as you're able, and let us together sing, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Thank you.
sin is the issue, but God still, in his mercy, we will see again, has people that he rescues. So, again, if you give your attention to the reading of God's word beginning in Isaiah chapter 59. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, or his ear dull that it cannot hear. But your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you, so that he does not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies, your tongue mutters wickedness. No one enters suit justly, no one goes to law honestly. They rely on empty pleas, they speak lies. They conceive mischief and give birth to iniquity. They hatch adder's eggs, they weave the spider's web. He who eats their eggs dies, and from one that is crushed, a viper is hatched. Their webs will not serve as clothing. Men will not cover themselves with what they make. Their works are works of iniquity, and deeds of violence are in their hands. Their feet run to evil, and they are swift to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity. Desolation and destruction are in their highways. The way of peace they do not know, and there is no justice in their paths. They have made their roads crooked. No one who treads on them knows peace. Therefore, justice is far from us, and righteousness does not overtake us. We hope for light, and behold, darkness. And for brightness, but we walk in gloom. We grope for the wall like the blind. We grope like those who have no eyes. We stumble at noon as in the twilight. Among those in full vigor, we are like dead men. We all growl like bears. We moan and moan like doves. We hope for justice, but there is none. For salvation, but it is far from us. For our transgressions are multiplied before you, and our sins testify against us. For our transgressions are with us, and we know our iniquities. Transgressing and denying the Lord, and turning back from following our God. Speaking oppression and revolt. Conceiving and uttering from the heart lying words. Justice is turned back and righteousness stands far away. For truth has stumbled in the public squares, and uprightness cannot enter. Truth is lacking, and he who departs from evil makes himself a prey. The Lord saw it, and it displeased him that there was no justice. He saw that there was no man, and wondered that there was no one to intercede. Then his own arm brought him salvation, and his righteousness upheld him. He put on righteousness as a breastplate, and a helmet of salvation on his head. He put on garments of vengeance for clothing, and wrapped himself in zeal as a cloak. According to their deeds, so he will repay. Wrath to his adversaries, repayment to his enemies. To the coastlands, he will render repayment. So they shall fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun. For he will come like a rushing stream, which the wind of the Lord drives. And a redeemer will come to Zion, to those in Jacob who turn from transgression, declares the Lord. And as for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit that is upon you, and my words that I have put in your mouth, shall not depart out of your mouth, or out of the mouth of your offspring, or out of the mouth of your children's offspring, says the Lord, from this time forth and forevermore. Let's further the reading of God's word be right as truth upon our hearts.
Keep those Bibles open and let's open up to Mark chapter 12. We're going to continue in our sermon series through the Gospel of Mark. We're going to finish up the Gospel of Mark through the rest of the year. But we're in verses 38 through 44 this morning in Mark chapter 12. Let's pray that the Holy Spirit would give us ears to hear as we turn our attention to God's Word yet again. Father in heaven, we do come asking that you would write the truths of Isaiah, our Old Testament reading, upon our hearts, as Pastor Don said, that we would know the Redeemer Jesus and that He would embolden us and awaken us to serve and to live only for His glory. And Father, even as we look at a life of glorified living or glorifying living, we pray that as we look at Mark chapter 12 with this story of the widow's offering, that we would see true blessedness, that we would see true devotion to Christ Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And may we learn from the whole heart and the whole service in which this widow gives her all to her beloved. Father, we do pray that You would give us those spiritual ears to hear, those spiritual minds able to understand, those spiritual hearts ready to receive this, Your Word. And we know that this is only a work of the Spirit. And so You tell us that if we need more of the Spirit, to simply ask. And as our good Father in heaven, You will give it to us. And so would You give us more of Your Spirit, pour Him out upon us afresh, so that we might take these truths, hear it, trust in it, and obey it, do it. In the name of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen. If you've ever attended a midweek prayer meeting service, or even one of our evening services where we pray maybe a more robust pastoral prayer, you might notice a theme within the prayers of the elders and the prayers of the people here. We often pray for what we would call revival. We often pray for what we would call revival. It's actually something that I pray for each and every day as I'm praying for the church during our work week here. It's that the Lord would spur us up for gospel living, that the Lord would spur us up for a love of the ordinary means of grace, the preaching of the Word, the prayers of the people, the sacraments, that the Lord would spur us up in our adoration of His name and His glory, that the Lord would stir us up in our honoring of the Lord's day. And so often I find myself reading about revival. One of my favorite books on revival is Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones's thick book on revival, I think you could say. But here recently I was reading an interview, I guess you could say, between Dr. Tim Keller and a Christian website, and they were talking about this idea of revival. And it's actually challenged me a little bit in my prayers for revival when Tim Keller says when we pray for revival, we really need to be praying for three different groups of people. He said the first group of people we need to be praying for is the nominal Christians. You know, those Christians who might be members of the church. They might actually come to church on a regular basis, but they are, in Tim Keller's words, playing church. And they play church for really all their lives. We need to pray for these nominal Christians to be truly born again, for them to be stirred up, to acknowledge their sin, to cast themselves upon the mercy of Jesus Christ. And then secondly, and I think this is probably the most humorously, I've read a lot of Tim Keller's works, and I can hear him saying this as I read it. He says we need to pray for the sleepy Christians. Now, you might not have slept real well last night, and you might be a little sleepy. That's not what Tim Keller's talking about. He's not talking about us needing a physical rest. He is talking about lazy Christians. He's talking about those Christians who are just kind of riding the bench, we might say. Sitting on the sideline, if we use that football analogy, it's now college football season, my favorite time of the year. That they're passive, they're inconsistent in their walk with the Lord. Might be too selfish to serve or too fearful to evangelize, Tim Keller says. He says we must pray when we're praying for revival for these lazy, sleepy Christians to wake up, to realize what they're missing out on, to stop sitting around, stop being an observer, but get into the game. And then the third group, of course, is the unbeliever. That we need to be praying for the unbeliever outside of the church. But we need to be praying for these unbelievers outside of the church to actually see the church being the true church. Seeing the church serving Christ, hearing the church preach the gospel so that unbelievers would come and to turn their lives over to Jesus. And so since I've read that interview, I've actually been praying those specific things to see professing believers become true believers, these nominal Christians to become true believers, to see these sleepy Christians wake up and get into the game, we might say, and to see unbelievers come to faith. Now you might think, why are you starting your sermon off with these things? Well, Jesus here in Mark chapter 12, verses 38 through 44, as he's talking about the scribes and the widows, is really talking about what genuine Christianity looks like. What genuine Christianity, discipleship, looks like for the church and the individual believer. It's not enough, I think, what Mark chapter 12, verses 38 through 44 is saying, that as a church we simply go through the motions of worship. I think that Mark chapter 12, verses 38 through 44 is telling us as individual believers, it's not enough to have our doctrine right, even though that's of utmost importance. But we need to know how to apply the Word, how to proclaim the Word, how to be true disciples of Jesus. And Jesus holds out the widow here before us as a picture, an illustration of how to do so. And so there's really two main points that I want to handle our text this morning. 38 through 40, I want to look at hypocrisy. And then verses 41 through 44, I want to look at true devotion. So hypocrisy and true devotion. With those things in mind, let us hear from God's Word. Again, verses 38 through 44. And in his teaching, he said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and like greetings in the marketplace, and have the best seats in the synagogues and the place of honor at the feasts, who devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation." And he sat down opposite of the treasury and watched the people putting money into the offering box. Many rich people put in large sums, and a poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which make a penny. And he called his disciples to him and said to them, "Truly I say to you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the offering box. For they all contributed out of their abundance, but she out of her poverty has put in everything that she had and all she had to live on." The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God remains forever and ever. Of course, here before us, Jesus is declaring through the Gospel of Mark that there are two contrasting figures before us this morning. First, of course, are the scribes, those members of the religious establishment who have, in a prideful way, puffed themselves up. And as they puff themselves up, they have squashed others. And of course, he compares this scribe, this member of the religious establishment, to the humble widow who gives everything that she has to God in service only to him. He is, of course, comparing what we would call hypocrisy with true devotion. And as we think about this idea of hypocrisy in verses 38 through 40, we have to have a good understanding or a good working definition of what hypocrisy is. And I think that we could just simply rewind back to Mark chapter 7. If you want to turn there, that's fine. But hear what Jesus has to say in Mark chapter 7 when he's confronting and chastising the Pharisees and the scribes for their actions. In verse 6 of chapter 7, he says to them, "Well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites? As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far away from me. In vain do they worship me." And I think Jesus right there gives us a good working definition of hypocrisy. He says the hypocrite, the Pharisees, the scribes, are those who honor God with their lips while their heart is far from Him. We might say that it's just simple lip service. They're void. Their hearts are void of true worship and obedience to Christ. And so when Jesus uses that working definition in Mark chapter 7, and He begins again to confront the religious establishment of their hypocrisy here in Mark chapter 12, He's telling them that there is rotten fruit to be born out of a hypocrite's heart. He actually goes into a lot of detail, practical detail, about what the scribes, these hypocrites, like to do in verses 38 through 40. He says, listen, they like to have the applause of men. They like to walk around in long robes to show their position of authority in the religious establishment. They like to be greeted with all the pomp and circumstance in the marketplace. They want to have the best seats in worship. They want to have the place of honor at feast. And they're doing it all so that they might be the show, that their eyes might be turned to them. And the implication of that is that their eyes would be turned away from Christ. And Jesus says, because of their hypocrisy, they will receive the greater condemnation. Well, of course, this isn't the first time that Jesus is describing the rotten fruit, if you will, of hypocrisy. Again, in Mark chapter 7, as Jesus is confronting the religious establishment, maybe even some of these same men that He is confronting here in Mark chapter 12, remember, He says, the rotten fruit of your hypocrisy is that you have riches and you say that they belong to Christ, and yet you will not take care of your elderly parents. You want to strip your money away from them. And He confronts them for their hard-heartedness. Well, here again in Mark chapter 12, He's saying that this fear of man, this greed, this pomp and circumstance where all eyes are on you and away from Jesus, this is again rotten fruit of hypocrisy. Jesus is emphasizing here that there is a religious hypocrisy that might look super spiritual in the eyes of those watching, but their hearts are far away from Christ. And it's interesting here, isn't it, that at the end of verse 40, He says for these hypocrites, for these scribes that are committing all of these sins, they might look religious, but their hearts are wicked. He says, essentially, I'm using a phrase from a commentator here, hell will be the hottest for such individuals. They'll receive the greater condemnation, Jesus says here at the end of verse 40. Those who are given the opportunity to study, to know the Scriptures, who have the responsibility even as the scribes to teach and lead others according to the Scriptures, they will be the ones judged more strictly, scrutinized more closely, condemned with more severity as they abuse their roles in which they have been given. And so let me warn you that as we sit under the preaching of the Word, as we sit under the study of the Scriptures, as we even sit under the reading of God's Word, as we've been reading through books of the Bible together as a congregation on Sunday morning, there is a warning here. For the more that you know, the more you will be judged for. And yet it gets more specific. It very specifically applies to men like me and Pastor Don who preach the Scriptures. It applies even more to those men who serve in the office of elder, as they are the ones qualified to teach and to guard the pulpit ministry of the church. It says that they will be judged with more or greater strictness. That's what James chapter 3 verse 1 says. It's one of those sobering verses, especially for me as I even read it here in the pulpit this morning. It says, not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that those who teach will be judged with a greater strictness. And of course, that's what the scribes are guilty of here in verses 38 through 40, as they put on the show of religion, but their hearts are wicked. Their hearts are tainted by sin. They have chosen evil. They have rejected Christ. They like the show. They like the pomp and circumstance. They like the prestige of being a part of the religious establishment, but they hate Christ and His gospel. And therefore, everything that they do is just for the flattery of man. And beyond just being full of pomp and circumstance, they're also guilty of greed, you see. And I think texts like 2 Peter 2:3 talks about false teachers who manipulate the system out of their love for money. It says this, "And in their greed they will exploit you with false words. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep." In the King James Version it actually says, through covetousness, they shall be fiend with merchandise of you. They only seek to benefit from you. And they'll use even religion, it says, to get or to meet their supposed needs. They're making merchandise of your souls, as one commentator puts it. They're using their spiritual platform to serve their own selfish desires. And I think the end of verse 40 is saying that this will not go unnoticed by God, but justice will certainly come in the end. If you ever read John Bunyan's book, The Pilgrim Progress, if you haven't, shame on you. You need to read it. But if you've read it, you know this scene that I'm about to mention, that Christian is talking to these two other men about this actual issue. Because these two other men have kind of formulated a justification for using religion and using faith to gain wealth in this world. And Christian actually responded. He says, "That man that takes up religion for the world will throw away religion for the world. For so surely as Judas designed the world in becoming religious, so surely did he also sell religion and his master for the same." I love that first phrase. That man that takes up religion for the world will throw away religion for the world. And your mind can go to all these TV evangelists, I think, that have constantly been on TV saying, sow your seed, send me money. And then 20 years later, you find out that they've been embezzling funds. And then they wind up in a federal prison. That's exactly what Jesus is talking about. That's exactly what Jesus is accusing these scribes of. They are taking God's money, putting it in their pockets, and they are squashing or devouring the widows so that they might do so. You know, a more modern day example, I think you might have heard about it, is a pastor stood up in the pulpit and he said the Lord told him that he needed his own private jet. And the church began just to throw money into the offering plates, and he bought his own private jet for ministry purposes. Well, his first trip was, of course, to the Caribbean for a family vacation. And, of course, it was a big controversy within the life of the church. There are false teachers. There are hypocrites who will try to line their own pockets in greed, and they'll use the religious establishment or their faithful platform to do so. We must be aware of those things, and we must beware of the scribes who are hypocrites. We must beware, beloved, of hollow spirituality. We must understand that there will be people who will seek their own treasure on earth rather than in heaven. There will be hypocrites who are filled with vanity and greed, and they desire the praises of men. And we cannot let those people be us. We must be humble. We must be transparent. We must not try to impress one another or compete with one another in the realm of holiness. We need to check our actions and our motives, and we really need to search our hearts and say, am I doing the Christian faith so that I might show off my spirituality, or am I doing it out of a love and honor of Christ? You know, it's real easy for us, in fact, if we're honest, it's real easy for me to pick on a man who stood up in a pulpit and said, God told me that I need a private plane. It's real easy to point a finger at him and say, that is a hypocrite. It's real easy for us to look at our neighbors and say, you know what, he or she or they claim to be Christians and yet they live like hypocrites, and we've yet to search our own hearts to see if there's any hypocritical nature even within us. We should be asking ourselves questions like, do I talk in certain ways to other Christians in hope of impressing them? Do I pray in certain ways when praying with others in the hopes that I might sound extra spiritual? Do I put on a mask? Do I portray things to other believers in a certain light that makes me look good? Am I the hero of every story I share? Do I minimize my sin? Do I exaggerate my practice of spiritual disciplines? Am I calling attention to my good deeds? Do I seek the praise of others? And I don't want to come across in the wrong way. I think that the fear is that we actually shut off because we never want to say that we pray or we act or we do the commandments of God so that we might be puffed up or accused of flaunting our spirituality. We don't need to get weird about this, I don't think. We're just saying we need to examine our motives. We need to examine our hearts so that we won't prove to be hypocrites. It's not that Jesus is condemning long prayers. It's not that Jesus is saying that long prayers are what automatically causes you to be judged by the Lord. That's a good thing. I was watching our Sunday evening service a number of weeks ago, and when I began the prayers of the evening, the pastoral prayer, where we pray a little bit more robustly on Sunday nights, due to our streamlined service, I noticed that I prayed for like 12 minutes. Thank God that He doesn't judge me for praying for 12 minutes. You might have. But nonetheless, the Lord didn't judge me. But if I did it for the applause of men, there's judgment from the Lord to be found. And so we need to be real. We need to be honest with our motives. God is not telling us through His Word to stop praying with other believers or sharing about your walk with the Lord. It's not that we are to stop talking about spiritual things, but we are called to be authentic, real, honest, not hypocrites. And so I ask that you would simply examine yourselves. And you say, well, Matt, I've been living like one of these scribes. Then repent. Repent of those sins and know that the blood of Christ cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Don't just use the Christian lingo and saying the right kind of prayers and talking about spiritual things so that you might be applauded by men. That's vanity. Don't use all the right lingo here in church and then not go home and read your Bibles and pray and live for Christ. That's hypocritical. Don't be full of greed when it comes to the life in which Christ has called us to live, but let's be in love with Him. You know, I think that's the way that we can examine ourselves, and I think that's the way that we can even fight against hypocrisy. It's simply a sacrificial, a wholehearted love for Christ. And I think that when we love Him, when we truly love Him, our delight in God will motivate us to do all kinds of things for His glory. And sometimes those things, as we move into the widow's offering and this idea of full devotion to the Lord, our full devotion to Him will make us do things, will lead us to do things that the world will say are absolutely foolish. Notice the scene here in verses 41 through 44. We're here within the midst of the believers. We're here within the midst of the worship service. Those who have come into the courts of the Lord so that they might worship the Lord. And you can see the treasury, the offering box, and you can see the line of people waiting to put their monies here into the treasury, the offering box. And you can hear, it seems, if you think about it in your sanctified imagination, you can hear the rich people dropping their coins into this treasury. In my mind, it's kind of like when I worked at Bilo in high school and we had a Coinstar machine and people would bring their piggy banks and their jars full of change. It was the most annoying sound in the world. You hear it clinging against the metal, and then you hear it, you know, the machine counting all these coins and it's rattling, and it's just absurd, the noise that this machine makes. That's kind of what we're experiencing here in the synagogue. In the temple, you hear the clinging of coins. You hear the bags of money being dumped in by the rich people. And then here comes this little widow who takes two coins, two small copper coins there in verse 42, which make a penny, and she drops. Plink, plink. And Jesus, immediately seeing her, calls his disciples to himself. And he says, truly I say to you, verse 43, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the offering box. Can you imagine the disciples' response here? Remember, the disciples, they're not rich men. They've left it all to follow Jesus. And so they see these big bags of money, and they hear the Coinstar machine, you might say, and they're hearing and watching all this happen, and then they see this widow lady, this poor little widow, drop the two copper coins. Everybody in the temple has heard this and seen this, and Jesus says, she's given more than anybody else. And I'm sure the disciples' mouths were gaped open going, what do you mean, Jesus? Have you not seen the rich people dropping their treasures here in the plate? And Jesus, of course, has seen it. But he says that she has given all. Look at verse 44. They all contributed, talking about the rich people, out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on. Here's Jesus. He's evaluating on a totally different value system, isn't he? What the world would say was foolish. How is this widow going to provide for herself? How is this widow going to live when she has given all that she has to Jesus? She has shown that her faith is not in any worldly treasure, but her faith is in Jesus Christ, her Lord and her Savior. And I think that's what full devotion is. Her devotion comes out of a wholehearted, a sacrificial love for her Master, her King. She bows a knee to King Jesus and she says, in obedience to Him, all of this is His. Everything I have is His. You know, oftentimes in our Americanized Christianity, I think you can say, we cite the Old Testament tithing system and we say, you know, God only requires 10% of our money and the other 90% is ours to do with as we please. And so we take our salary, don't we? And then we argue if we have to pay it, our tithes on our gross or our net, and we have this long debate over that. And then we have to say, okay, let's divide it by 10% and that 10%, of course, is going to go to the Lord. And this 90%, I'm going to go do whatever I want to do. It's my money. Those are my shares. This is God's. This is mine. And that's how we live our life. But I remember what Mr. Howard Sloan told me years and years ago as I began to lead a family in marriage. I said, how in the world am I to budget? How in the world am I to make sure I can meet ends meet? How in the world am I to do this and that and to make sure that I'm given to the Lord, supporting the church, and I'm providing for my family? And he simply said, Matt, it's all the Lord's. And I actually challenged him. I think I had a hypocritical heart here. I said, no, Mr. Howard, you know, I grew up in the Pentecostal church, 10%. You give your 10% and that's all you need to give. And Mr. Howard started laughing. He goes, well, 10% is a good place to start. And I thought, boy, that is the most wise words I've ever heard in my life. Because it's not my shares and the Lord's shares. My riches, and they're not riches, but all that I have, all that you have, is the Lord's. And yeah, He wants you to use some of your money to provide for your family. He wants you to use your money to be wise, but we cannot think about it in His shares and our shares, or His money and our money. We must say in full obligation and honor to Him, this is His money. These are His blessings that He has bestowed upon me. How best am I to honor Him with what I have been given? You know, one of the things that's implied here in this story of the widow's offering in verses 41 through 44 is, of course, this idea of blessing. This idea of blessing. The widow has put her faith in her King. The widow has bowed a knee to King Jesus. And what Jesus is saying here, in full implication, is the hypocrite will be condemned and judged by the Lord. But those who cling to Christ in faith, the one who says, everything that I have belongs to my King because He is the sovereign one over all the world. He is the one, she is the one that is going to be blessed. I know a father in the faith who early in his ministry, he says that, or he tells the story that they didn't have much money. They were putting kids through school and they were giving to the church, and ministry is not the most lucrative position in the world to be. And so, you know, there's budgets, and they received some letters from some missionaries that needed some kind of end-of-the-year givings. And this minister, this father in the faith, looks at his wife, because she was the one who did the budget, and said, can we afford to give anything? And she goes, well, you know, we have this money laid aside for the kids' Christmas presents and for me to go to the grocery store to buy Christmas dinner. And he says, write the checks. And it was, you know, very little money at the time, $35, $45 or so a piece, I think is how the story goes. And they stepped out in faith. They gave all that they had so that they might say, we are going to give for Christ and His kingdom. And he says that he went to work and the wife wrote the checks, put them in the mail, and that afternoon he checked the mail as he returned home from work, and he received back, just through divine providence, smiling providence, he received a check from a family friend, and it was double what they had just given to these missionaries to Christ. And he says, here is the blessings of the widow's offerings, that if you will, that if you will cling to Christ in faith, He will bless you for it. And sometimes that means that He will call you to give Him your all. And we must be obedient. And that means sometimes He will call us to do what the world might say foolish things. He might call us to be international missionaries or pastors. He might call us to live in smaller homes so that we might give more to the cause of the kingdom. All these things He might call us to. And the simple fact is that we must humbly be obedient. That if we will contribute all that we have, if we will say all that we have is the Lord's and I'm going to use it as He sees fit, that we will be blessed. And I think the good news about this, furthermore, is that He promises to use even the smallest gifts. You might think, well, Matt, I don't have a lot of money. Of course, that's applied here in the text. Or I don't have, we can take it a step further, I don't have many talents. I have very little to offer the church. What could Jesus possibly do with me or my limited Bible knowledge or my limited understanding or my limited money? What could the Lord do with little old me? Well, the Lord can do much with a little in His kingdom. Because He's not looking at dollars and cents. He's looking at hearts. And so we need to give our hearts totally to Him, knowing that in the kingdom, as we wholeheartedly serve our Lord, our King, we will now live wholly and wholeheartedly for Him, and He will bless us. Because our treasures aren't here on earth. Our treasures are in heaven, where we get to experience the very presence of God forevermore. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we do thank you for the opportunity to come be challenged by your word. And we pray, O Lord, that it would encourage us where it needs to encourage us, that it would convict us where it needs to convict us, that we would search our hearts and say, if there's any hypocritical sin within us, may it be cast out and repented of, so that we might focus wholeheartedly on thee and serve thee to the best of our abilities as we seek to bring honor to your name. Father, we pray that we would be a sold-out people for Jesus. And even if the world says that we are foolish, let us know that our treasures, our acceptance, is not here on earth, but our treasures are laid up for us in heaven eternal, where we will get to spend eternity with you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we sing in response to God's word, if you'll open up your hymnals and let's turn to hymn number 701. We'll sing Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. Please stand as you're able and let's sing aloud. Shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.